if you go back to, and this is different for every practitioner of what a puppet is, you know, when does the puppet come alive, or how does the puppet come alive? And I think the puppet comes alive not necessarily just in the performer's hand. I think the performer, like a musician, manipulates the instrument, makes the music, makes the voice, if it has a voice. But the experience of music lives between the listening ear and the violin. Just like puppetry, the life of the puppet exists somewhere between the audience and the performance of it. And I'm not meaning to sound all woo-woo voodoo here, but I really believe that. Otherwise, you're just playing with dolls by yourself. Puppetry is a performing art. It has to be a performing art. It has to be for an audience of one or a thousand. So I think because of that, it's a mysterious little devil to some people. I think because the puppet demands that you suspend your disbelief. It demands that you engage and put something into it, even if you, as a passive audience member, don't know you're doing it. But even if at a public rally you see a giant puppet or a small puppet show in protest, you engage with that puppet because it's childlike, because it's dismissible in a way. And when something is dismissible and innocent, it can deliver a heavier punch, no pun intended or pun intended, in the message it has. So to reference history again, you know, Skupa's plays during the Nazi occupation were passed by the Nazi censors to be performed. But they were so rich in metaphor that the Czech audience knew exactly what those characters were talking about, even though the Nazis thought it was just a straight, simple little story. So once they identified that these simple little puppet shows that were so popular, and that these characters who were national figures in Czechoslovakia were saying something against the Nazi occupiers, well, then Skupa became an enemy. He became an enemy. And I think that's what happens over and over, is that this dismissible little art form, be it on the park or be it on the stage, it doesn't matter where. Sometimes even, I was reading, I think it was on your site last year, you know, in the Middle East, a television or a web series being done covertly. It's when something seems innocent and dismissible and it packs a punch that then it becomes a bigger danger to authority. Because authority doesn't understand childlike wonder and magic anymore, because they've totally sold themselves to power, and power does corrupt, right? And so it becomes a battle of trying to control that thing that exists between a performer and an audience. And I'd like to see someone try and control that, because it only exists in the moment it exists. When performer and audience go away, it vanishes. It lives only in memory. And memory and experience are what people are best at. You know, once you've elicited a thought in someone's mind that makes them think, ah, that's wrong, or I don't like the way I feel about this, it's hard to change them back. It's easier to kill them. So I think that's why puppets are dangerous. But it takes authority a bit longer to figure out that they're dangerous, because we're the invisible artists on the planet, puppeteers, you know, we're not beloved, revered state artists, and I think that's the best thing that's happened to us. You know, we should always be a little under the wire. You know, Obrazov being a state artist, being a party member, you know, and, you know, when I went to see his theater, I think 400 employees in that one state theater, probably 2/3 of them were the party faithful placed there. You know, to either spy on everyone else, or they were there just to have a good job because they were party faithful. But, you know, in Tinka's New Dress, I created these two characters, Franz and Schnitzel, who were based, as I said earlier, on Schwebel and Hrvinek. And we see an old puppeteer doing the classic version of his characters, and then we see the young renegade puppeteer doing his, where he uses Franz and Schnitzel to goad the government and to talk about things that are dangerous. And then we see his contemporary, Phipsy, who is trained by the same old puppeteer and their best friends as children. And they both take the same characters, and Phipsy becomes a state artist. And Franz and Schnitzel mouth the official party line of what the common good, which is the government's name in the play, wants to say. So, you know, we can look at puppetry and see that. I mean, you can see some of the most sanitized spokesmen on the planet as puppets, certainly in America, you know, where, you know, and even educational television has gotten corrupted by money and toy sales. Educational television, it should just go away for a few years while everyone rethinks it, I think. But certainly television commercials and corporate events and all of those things. I'm not knocking anyone for making a living doing that. A lot of contemporary puppeteers make their living doing that stuff. So good on them. But at the end of the day, I still don't think that's what our art form does best. I think we're better than selling laundry soap, frankly.